in the cloud. So that's now recording.
Yeah, we just had the voice set recording in progress.
Great. Now, what I suggest you do is kill your audio, because I'm going to do, unless...
Are you sure?
Well,
Oh, no, during the film.
No. What I'm going to say is kill your audio stream and your video stream when we're showing the films.
Okay.
I've got a little bit of spiel that I'm going to do to introduce you, and then I'm probably going to rattle on for a couple of minutes, and then go into a bit of spiel about the themes, such as it is, and then I will kick us off. So I'm gonna hopefully go live now, and we'll see how this goes. Great. Okay, well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to our Trends and Tales from the World of Machinima event. This is going to be hosted by the And Now for Something Completely Machinima podcast team. So just to let you know that we're recording this evening's session, and we will be posting it on our YouTube channel. So it's on my YouTube channel at the moment, but will also be posted on the Completely Machinima YouTube channel shortly. I'm Tracy Harwood. I'm a professor of digital culture at the Institute of Creative Technologies, De Montfort University in Leicester. I was the director of the first European Machinima Film Festival in 2007, which took place also in Leicester, and have earlier this year published a book with Ben Grussey, who was the original community manager for machinima.com before it became Inc. in the early 2000s. And together we worked on the pioneers in Machinima and the grassroots of virtual production book, which I said was published in April. Speaking of whom, my co-presenters this evening and co-hosts on the podcast are Ricky Grove and Damien Valentine. Hello, both of you.
Hi.
Nice to have you here.
Mm. Hello.
Hi. Damien is in the dark in the world of the Matrix, which is very appropriate for today. So let me just tell you a little bit about these guys. Ricky has a long history of involvement in Machinima, but prior to that has a background in professional acting and has appeared in films such as Army of Darkness and TV shows such as ER. In Machinima, he's been involved in numerous productions as voice director, actor and sound designer since the early 2000s. As well as the main producer of the Completely Machinima podcast, along with Phil Rice, who's unfortunately not here this evening, we collectively began working on the podcast earlier this year. Ricky is also managing editor and writer of Renderosity magazine, but mostly he will tell you his passion is for books. And he has a lifetime of involvement in the bookstore and book selling market, and I don't mean academic books. We're also joined this evening by Damien Valentine, otherwise known as Darth Angelus, who has also been involved in Machinima from its earliest days as director, writer, editor, producer, and a cinematographer. Damien is particularly passionate about sci-fi games and movies. He's made films inspired by Buffy. I never get that right. Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and received wide acclaim for his original series, The Chronicles of Humanity. His current Machinima series is Heir to the Empire, and it's based on, I think, Timothy Zane's novels that expand the Star Wars universe, which has proven to be hugely popular on YouTube among his fan communities. Like I said, unfortunately, Phil isn't able to be with us this evening, but Phil has a fantastic history in Machinima too. He's our fourth host on the podcast. And by way of a bit of background, Phil is another of the pioneers that Ben and I talk about in our book. He's made around 50 films since he began in the 1990s. In this genre, and his work has been featured in numerous film festivals and exhibitions around the world over the years, and his best known film is actually in the Guinness World Records. So as well as producing and directing films, his talent also extends to singing and songwriting. So that's us. Now, what we're going to be doing this evening is showing you a few of our films from the last year that we've been looking at as we've been making this podcast. We're going to just give you a sort of a flavour of some of the comments that we made as we were reporting on those films. But if you want to know a little bit more about the films themselves, or have a listen to what we had to say about the films in more detail, then you can go back to the podcast episodes, and we'll give you links to all the episodes that are on the completelymachinima.com website as we kind of go through the evening. So I'll add those to the chat, and you can pick them up at your leisure. Of course, you can also subscribe to the completelymachinima.com podcast itself, and that's running, streaming on all the main channels, including Apple, Amazon, Google, and any other channel you like to pick up. Through that podcast, you can get in touch with us in a range of ways. So you can contact us through our website, through various media, social media channels. You can leave us a voice message. You can chat to us on our Discord server. There's a few of us in there periodically, I have to say. We're not massively into the Discord server at the moment, but you can get in touch with us in a whole variety of ways. So what we're going to do now, as I said this evening, is show you some films in full. We're going to put the links on the YouTube channel with the full credits to the creators, and on our blog too, which will include the links back to this sort of full discussion. We'd like you to sort of sit back, enjoy the films, and just to say many thanks to Ben, who's helped prepare the films for us this evening. The other thing to say is, don't hesitate to drop a few questions into the YouTube chat. Now, we've got Jason Boomer in the YouTube chat for us this evening. So if there's anything that you want to ask, Jason can sort of pick those questions up and drop them over to us here in Zoom. So, yeah, before we start the films, what I want to do is just highlight, by sort of way of a general overview, some of the trends and themes that we've collectively observed through the course of the year. We've seen a huge amount of incredible creative works. I think that would be fair to say. We've all been probably quite surprised at how Machinima has evolved since we've, you know, been in it for such a long time, and now just sort of picking up again with some of our observations through the podcast. I think it'd be fair to say it's moved well beyond those early days of game-based Let's Plays and parodies. Although that was true by the early 2000s too, I think. And in fact, another part of our podcast has been about the history of Machinima. And Ben has been leading on those episodes where he's reflected on some of the very earliest days of Machinima, some of the seminal moments that you can reflect on and go back to the earliest years. And I think if you contrast those episodes of our podcast with some of the other episodes, you'll see just how much of a movement we've got in this creative form, contrasting those early days with the reviews of the newer works that we've been focusing on primarily in these other episodes. So I think what's fair to say is what's become very evident through that is there's now a massive breadth of creative forms. So the first trend really is the breadth of creativity. And over the year, we've reviewed things like parodies and stories based on books, TV, films, games and music, and also many new and original stories inspired by aspects of these, which really do push the boundaries of what Machinima used to be. Of course, we'll never escape the Let's Play phenomenon, which was largely spawned by the machinima.com years, whose story itself finally came to a bit of a sticky end in 2019. And I think it would be fair to say we were all shocked and dismayed when Machinima Inc. switched off the servers last year, 2020, to all the content that creators had basically entrusted them with. since the sale of the website back in very early 2004 by one of the pioneers in Machinima, which was Hugh Hancock, and his company, Strange Company. That aside, of course, the other big change over the years has been the massive monetized growth of content creators generally. However, in the indie world of Machinima, what we've taken note of this year is the new types of storytelling that we see, new types of documentary, narrative, live performed forms, and also things like digital comments, as well as a bit of VR storytelling. Some of these have been created using traditional tool sets that Machinima grew out of, the games themselves, but we've noticed a massive increase in the adoption and use of real-time filmmaking tool sets such as iClone, Unreal, and Blender. And we've also commented throughout the year on the releases of a breadth of supporting tools, which you can find out about on the blog and in our monthly news episodes. Clearly, the pandemic has also had a profound impact on the world of Machinima. Well, I think we're all probably use the term real-time filmmaking and Machinima now interchangeably. And I would say it's Industrial Light and Magic's Mandalorian real-time production process, which has had a massive, which has been a massive inflection point pre-pandemic. But we're seeing now similar types of large-scale lead wall-based studios pop up all over the world, which kept the film industry on the road, so to speak, during the pandemic. But on top of that, we've also seen quite sophisticated home-based setups with new generations of computers with advanced graphics capabilities, making kits ever more accessible to indie studios, home-based studios, really. And tool sets such as NVIDIA's Omniverse make remote working collaborations for high-quality production processes achievable and scalable. And their advanced integration with the likes of Unreal and iClone have really pushed the boundaries. And I know Ricky's got something to say about that a little bit later on as well. So I think some of these tool sets, all at really no or low cost for some of the software, notwithstanding the investment in the kit and the assets that you still need alongside that. So I think what's been particularly impressive to note during the year is the usability of the tools for new and established creators, which of course will ultimately serve the aims of many of the bigger players, which is to grow the digital creative sector generally. In turn, these new creators and startups will feed into the industry, but hopefully this time, through that massive growth in skill sets that they are basically supporting, we should not see the problems, I think, that we saw back in 2008, when many of the Machinima pioneers, the likes of Paul Marino, for example, who were snatched from the community by the AAA studios, seeking to absorb the real-time creative capabilities that the Machinima community had evolved from its earliest days. So the consequences of that back then were really dire for the indie community generally, and combined with the power of YouTube and the machinima.com focus, almost destroyed what the pioneers had set out to do, which was basically revolutionize creative practice and processes for creative production values rather than content and marketing values, which is what instead prevailed. That said, what has emerged from the emphasis is new ways in which indie creators can generate income. This year, I think we've seen the growth of monetization strategies that finally extend beyond the YouTube model, thank God. Of course, the advertising approach remains one of the key strategies, but clearly changes to the algorithm through which only the most popular creators emerge as winners has clearly been very limiting. And in turn, that's led to an explosion of tutorial type content through which creators have been able to manipulate their viewing figures in order to promote their own original creative works. Others have, however, turned to platforms such as Patreon and Ko-fi, where they raise money directly from their most loyal viewers and fan communities, and also post content just for those viewers, effectively sidestepping the dominant streaming models. What's interesting about that, and I think we're only really at the beginning of that, is that this is now once again about word of mouth and communities of interest and practice, which was always the heart of Machinima and the original real-time community. So in terms of communities, of course, game worlds have become big business. We've seen most recently, the world domination efforts being made by Meta. But of course, harnessing the metaverse is really well beyond one organization's capability, which frankly lacks a killer app. I know we can sort of say Facebook is a killer app, but you know what they're talking about needs a killer app, and they haven't really any longer got it. So so-called metaverse environments really are nothing new. And whether that's, you know, whether we're talking really about fantasy role play or mirror worlds, I think really what we're talking about, to me, is the way that, in terms of the way that Meta is operating, it kind of reminds me of what Machinima tried to do when they took over the word Machinima way back when. Anyway, environments such as Second Life, World of Warcraft, and many others persist from the early 2000s, as do those who create and tell stories in those worlds, and the newer ones such as Fortnite, Minecraft, and others. And we have some examples of those to show you this evening from some of the more sci-fi worlds. So I think that you can see that the metaverse environments will continue to be an impressive creative platform for Machinima and real-time filmmaking. And finally, we've noticed the use of motion capture technologies. We've seen some very impressive uses of mocap for indie filmmaking over the year. And whilst there are some very expensive setups in use, mostly what we've seen is the use of quite low-cost kit, markerless and mobile phone facial capture technologies being used, which frankly changed the way in which character assets can be animated and used to tell stories with new depths in performance capability as a consequence. So those are the trends that I've observed anyway. I'm sure the other guys will have something to say when we look at some of the films that they've selected. So I think with that sort of brief overview in mind, what I want to do now is move on and let's take a look at some of the films that we've picked. And frankly, I have to say, it's been quite a difficult choice picking out some of the films. We've had some amazing work to review this year, as I've already said. But here we go. What we're going to do now is each of us introduce some films we've selected and then just kind of briefly comment on it. Naturally, being the lead presenter this evening, I'm going to start us off. You're not bored enough of listening to me at the moment. Sorry about that. So the first film is going to be one called Adrift. Now, to make this film, the studio, which is called Barely Not Monkeys Producers, used Patreon to raise the funds and filmed it in an open world game called Star Citizen. They've used facial motion capture to animate the characters and also professional and relatively well-known actors to voice the characters, which I think is an interesting strategy for indie studios and something which takes me back to Hugh Hancock, who employed mocap and actors Brian Blessed, Joanna Lumley, Jack Davenport, and Anna Chancellor in character roles for his Machinima called Death Knight Love Story back in 2014. So he was pioneering even as late as sort of 15 odd years after he'd started the movement, really. Anyway, Adrift was released in September this year, and we reviewed it in our November films episode. It's 13 minutes long, so bear with me whilst I fire it up and enjoy the film. Just find the film. Share the screen. Okay, so here we go.
Warning, suit malfunction. Warning, suit malfunction. Warning, suit malfunction. Stabilizers malfunction. Stabilizers malfunction. Thrusters malfunction. Warning, heart rate above suitable levels. Unable to divert power to life support. Warning, unable to divert power to life support. Initiating system restart.
I'm sorry, Dad.
Thank you. Pay for this ship before you blow it up?
Ha ha, hearty har, aren't you hilarious?
Your dad.
I know.
Now let's vacuum up and get on to the next one.
At least I have an old windbag to keep me company.
Hey, Pearl, shh.
What?
Clear the comms.
You hear that?
Gross. Gross!
That's teriyaki.
My scan shows some hadronite on this surface.
Yeah? That's great.
Yeah, I'm going to hand extract.
I'll do it. You need a break.
What? No. You're up there in what? Your underwear just drinking hooch or something and just singing away?
Wait, we have hooch?
I'm all geared up. I got it. Yeah, that's real special. Oh shit. Oh shit.
Good morning, sunshine. While we wait for tea, can you please tell me why you had your beam cranked so high? Can you tell me why you ignore every safety protocol? Perhaps explain me why you don't just kill me now and save me the heart attack.
We have experienced a critical rupture, rapidly depressurizing.
Distress signal?
Not much time. Mayday.
It's not far. Just outside the asteroid belt, less than an hour.
You'd better bill them for our time.
Who raised you?
Quantum trap. Engage.
at that.
Whoa.
Ship, Starfarer. Manufacturer, Musashi Industrial and Starflight Concern. Name, Hermes. Not listed in the Interplanetary Ship Registry.
Smugglers.
Illegal goods.
This may get interesting.
Please let this be interesting.
You ready to suit up? Pearl? Here we go.
Scorch marks. Hull is blown to hell. This was no accident. Pirates, maybe.
Think there's any survivors?
Someone had to send that distress call.
Let's go see.
Wait, wait!
Dad, come on!
Nah, you know better.
Eyes open, clear ahead. Use what you got, or end up dead.
Ready?
Let's go, dork.
Oxygen level at 60%. Oxygen.
Where is the crew?
So, if I get this thing started, do I get to keep it? I know how to weld.
Honey, Jesus Christ couldn't resurrect this mess.
Well, he was a carpenter. I'm a mechanic. Imagine me running trades in this bad boy. Ah!
And there's the first body. I'm on it. Wait, this guy's alive.
What?
He's breathing, but barely. His oxygen suit levels are out of whack and his power readings are almost zero. If I get him back to the Virginia fast, there's a chance I could stabilize him. You should come with me.
Someone needs to keep looking for survivors, and you know the medical stuff.
How's your oxygen? You were mining for a while.
I'm at like 80%.
Like 80%?
80%. All right. I'm good.
Fine. But you check the crew quarters, then get your ass back to the ship. Am I clear?
Crystal.
Contents. Harpitin, an experimental drug for nervous system conditions. Currently illegal in some systems. Approximate value, 200,000 UEC.
Holy.
You're in the cargo bay, aren't you?
No! Yes. I was looking for...
survivors?
Yes, of course. What?
Now?
There could be survivors in the cargo bay.
Are there?
No.
Crew quarters, stat.
Hey, Dad. Still no bodies, but none of the escape pods have been ejected. This guy couldn't have been flying a rig this size alone, right?
It's an undocumented ship. It's not like he was following fleet protocol.
And how is he?
Stable, still unconscious.
I think he'll be fine. What about you? How's your O2 level?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Hey, Pearl.
Yeah?
You want me to sing you a song?
No. No, don't you dare. Ah! Okay. I worry, I promise. I worry if you just shut up.
And everyone leaves!
Thank you. Hey, Dad, I'm seeing scorch marks coming from inside the hole. Oh, Dad! They're dead, they're here, all of them, they're here! Dad? Dad! Dad, can you hear me?
Warning, suit malfunction. Warning, suit malfunction.
Okay, so do you know what? I just realized that was actually dead calm in space. That was that film, wasn't it? which, you know, I have to say, this was for me one of those rare films when actually I think we all agreed, all of us on the podcast agreed, that it was well made, great story. The mocap enhanced the facial animations considerably, and the voice acting quality put this film head and shoulders above a lot of indie type creations that we've seen. We enjoyed the repartee between the characters and the journey of the story itself. And I think it'd be fair to say we're all looking forward to episode 2, which still isn't out, by the way, because I've checked. We were also impressed with Star Citizen and what potential it actually has for creating machinima. I think it'd be fair to say our concerns when we were talking about this was that the gap, because of the way that it had been produced and the episodes had been produced through the funding strategy, was how long it might be between episodes, because it's a four-part series, between each of these episodes. And as a consequence, what that might mean for audience engagement. So that's one of the challenges I think you have to figure through when you're raising money using a platform like Patreon. But it's probably less of a concern than it might have been, I think. And I know, Ricky, you wanted to comment on this one too. Do you want to sort of pick up on your views of it?
Sure. It was a delight to watch it again. I found myself completely engaged in the story and forgetting that I was on some sort of presentation and had to comment on it because I was so wrapped up in it. And I think that kind of filmmaking is what machinima and real-time filmmakers strive for, that suspension of disbelief. Sure, there's some technical issues, you know, but with a good story, it doesn't make any difference. And I think that's the theme that I wanted to hit on. I wanted to make two points. One is the theme overall is the attention to story. I think it's been a problem in machinima since the very beginning, because it's so much fun to create all sorts of fancy visuals and to show that you can do all sorts of great tracking camera shots. If you remember the beginning of Boogie Nights, it starts on this big high platform, comes down, goes into the club, follows the people. I mean, the whole continuous shot for 9 minutes. But in that case, it serves the story. The problem with a lot of machinima, especially early machinima, it was a show-off. Well, you don't have any of that in this production because the story is the most important thing. And I think that's my second point, is that too many filmmakers in machinima neglect that aspect of it. They pour all of their efforts into detail of getting just the right ship, just the right VFX, just the right mocap, just the right actors to do everything, but they don't spend nearly as much time on getting the story right. And that's really the spine of the presentation. And in this film, it's obvious they spent a lot of time trying to get the story right. And as you mentioned at the beginning of of your comments, I'm a big reader, and science fiction is one of my favorite genres to read in. And I read continuously contemporary science fiction all the time. And although there's, as you mentioned, there's some derivative dead calm Or what was that? What was the name of that film that you mentioned?
Dead Calm, yeah.
Dead Calm.
Yeah.
There are certain, it's derivative. However, it's unique enough that it uses the bones of that story to create its own unique thing. Mm-hmm. And the key in this thing is the relationship between the daughter and the father. And the fact that the gender issues are so contemporary. Here you have this smart, interesting, young, fun female character, but also is a bit reckless. And their relationship as the father is trying to keep her back from causing trouble. I suspect that that quality of her recklessness is going to come into play in further episodes, and it's going to prove to be very helpful. It's going to make a difference in the story. So basically, that's all I wanted to say, other than the fact I was delighted you chose this film. I was going to choose it myself. And
I think Phil was going to choose it too, had he been able to join us, which is, so I'm probably Damien as well.
Yeah, you guys beat me to it.
Yeah, exactly. I've just picked up a comment in the chat from Jason, actually. He said it reminded me of Serenity, Firefly, and bringing a Reaver aboard. I'm not sure what that is, but
yeah.
Great stuff. I'm conscious of time. We're only running until 7:30 this evening. So, Ricky, I'm going to hand the next one over to you for this evening. So let me know when you want me to play the film.
Sure, and that's Obit?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Obit by Phil Rice is my choice. In fact, I chose two films. I hope we can get them both in. They're short. I chose them firstly because they're good films, but secondly, they illustrate several ideas that I want to make about where Machinima was and where Machinima is today. Today, filmmakers have so many tools. In fact, during the heyday of Machinima, people were always complaining about they don't have enough tools, they don't have enough content, they don't have enough ways to make them. Boy, I wish I had the ability to do this, to create specialized animation, facial animation. Well, they have all of those things now. Although they don't call it Machinima, they call it real-time filmmaking. Although they're really essentially synonymous things. But Obit is a film that is made in the older style of Machinima. And that means is that you take a game engine, you hack the game engine in order to create tools that allow you to tell a story. Phil chose the game Red Dead Redemption 2 to make his film in. And Red Dead Redemption 2 has very, very limited ability for filmmakers to shoot in, even though it's an open world and has massive possibilities of scenes and characters. So he really had to work hard to come up with tools that would allow him to make movies in it. And even then he had to struggle because he couldn't predict exactly how the characters were going to behave. So he had to shoot, put them in a certain situation and shoot until he got them to do what he wanted them to do. Now that's just that's old time Machinima and takes a lot of patience. New real time cinema, say in Unreal, if he had shot this film in Unreal, he'd have all the ability to shoot anything he wanted, but he chose to do it in Red Dead Redemption 2 because that game affected him in a way that made him want to tell a specific story that came from his own life. And if you go to our episode in which we talk about this, Phil shares some of the personal background to it. And that's basically what I wanted to say. It's a marvelous film. It's short. It shows off why Phil has created some of the keystone works in Machinima because of his attention to detail, his ability to tell stories which are grounded in life, and his wonderful sense of color and shape in when he makes a film. So let's take a look at Obit and we'll talk about it afterwards.
Yeah, let me just fire it up. Okay. We'll kill our videos. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Owen was, by all accounts, a good man. An honest man. A decent man. He took care of his wife and his children. And he was kind to his neighbors. A farmer by trade, he was not a wealthy man, yet his reputation was one of generosity. There are more than a few people here who received unannounced gifts from the bounty of Owen's farm at just the time they needed it most. Many have tried and none have succeeded in figuring out how Owen always seemed to know when folks needed a helping hand. There are many things Owen was, but Owen wasn't a Christian. We believe that God is merciful. Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." May God have mercy on his soul. I confess, I really struggled to come up with the words today. I meant what I said. Your father was a good man, decent and trustworthy, kind and generous, no doubt about it. But it doesn't matter. What becomes of a good man who rejects the blood of Jesus? I have a lot of respect for your mama, you know? What am I supposed to do? Tell a widow her husband is facing hellfire because his good works amount to nothing? Because he didn't accept Jesus? I'm committed to the truth, and that is the truth. But is there really no hope? And then it hit me. When Owen was lying there on his porch, after his heart stopped, he was probably still alive for a few seconds. And just like time seems different when we're sleeping and dreaming, those few seconds probably seemed like a lot more time than that to Owen. Maybe in that window of time, God in his mercy sent Jesus to minister to Owen even as his body lay there. And maybe Owen gave in and accepted Jesus as his savior. Now, if that happened, Owen is in heaven right now. That's what I told your mama. I hope it helps her, gives her some hope. Sure, the chances are pretty slim, but...
So that was Phil's film Obit, which was released in September. We actually dedicated a whole episode to interrogating Phil about that film, and he was really forthcoming, which was fascinating to hear him talk about Obit, as Ricky was talking about. So it's in episode 9.1 of our October podcast, and we'll put links to that on the chat and also on the description of the video as well. Okay, so our next film is over to Damien, actually. We've got the next two films, actually, Damien, over to you. So do you want to kick us off with this next one?
Yeah, I would be happy to. So the next film is The Hamilton Incident, and it's made with a game called Elite Dangerous. And like Star Citizen, it's a big open world online game. And it simulates the entire galaxy so players can, you know, fly off and explore it. That's 400 billion stars. And part of the lore of the game is only a tiny small section of the game world has been explored by humanity. The rest of it's completely unknown. There's lots of mystery out there, and the developers have hidden all kinds of things for people to find. And so this film takes that concept of the unknown of the galaxy, of the game world, and creates a story where the characters find something. I don't want to give away too much because it's all the spoilers and everything. One of the things I was really intrigued by this film when I discovered it was you don't see a single character. It's all told through the ships and the vehicles, and they're all flying around, but you never see a single human face or character model, except for one brief shot at the beginning, which I'm not quite sure how they even accomplished that, because that wasn't part of the game when they made this film. And I really enjoyed the atmosphere of it. I was impressed by the way that they did this without showing any human faces, and it kind of leaves it to your imagination. What do these characters look like? And because you can hear them talking, but you don't see them. So it leaves a lot to the imagination, which is a way that it's a very difficult thing to pull off successfully, because you can leave out so much that it's just not interesting. So getting it just right is quite a challenge. And I think this film by Vindicator Jones did that perfectly. So I don't want to say too much because, again, spoilers. So let's just watch it and see what you guys think.
I'll just share it and play it.
Open up comms before I delete your entire audio library.
Hey, this is classic stuff. Some people don't have good taste in music. Comms are now open, your royal commanderness.
Unidentified distress signal. This is Commander Whittaker aboard the deep space salvage vessel Hamilton. Please respond. I say again, unidentified distress signal. This is Commander Whittaker aboard the deep space salvage vessel Hamilton. Please respond immediately. Well, looks like no reply, Commander. You're thinking what I'm thinking? Well, don't get your hopes up just yet. We need to check it out first. Let's do this by the books. I don't want to screw up our salvage rights just because of a stupid technicality.
Roger that, Commander.
Plotting descent course and locking onto beacon. Approaching beacon, Commander. Seems to be an old settlement or colony. There's still no response, and sensors are detecting no surface activity. Okay, take us within 2,000 meters and prep a fighter. I'll take it in for a closer look. Fighter is prepped, telepresence online, opening hangar doors and lowering fighter into position. Launching fighter. All systems. lights on, and I don't see any movement. It looks pretty quiet down there. I'm gonna come around for a second pass. I'm getting some weird readings, but that could be interference from the beacon. I can't see anything moving down there at all. This place is dead. I'm bringing the fighter back on board. Lower landing gantry and prepare for a retrieval process. Roger that, gantry is deployed. Prepare an SRV for manual operation and land at these coordinates. You're going up there in person? Are you sure it's safe? Honestly, it looks deserted. Whatever happened here looks like it happened a long time ago. I'm probably gonna have to get out and manually log onto the settlement's computer anyway and get it back up and running. I'm sure it's safe. But hey, thanks for worrying about me. I never knew you cared.
Hey, I just wanted to make sure that when I lock on weapons to the SRV that you're
going to be in there when I open fire. You bastard. Approaching landing site now, Commander. Extending gear. Approach speed is good. Touchdown. Engines are offline, deploying SRV.
Okay, I'm in the SRV heading out. You better not leave without me.
So, it's now a good time to discuss my share percentage in the salvage?
Is now a good time to discuss the remote explosive device I have underneath your chair?
Whoa, so touchy. I have you on ship scanners and telemetry feed is online.
Roger that. I have the colony within visual range.
But I'm still getting a lot of strange readings from the scanners. Perhaps they had a reactor leak and the radiation is affecting our instruments. Maybe that's why they abandoned the colony. I assume you're wearing protection. Never leave home without it. Strange though, my scanners are not registering any spikes in radiation. I'm reading changes in the area density usually associated with movement, but there is nothing down there. I'm approaching the settlement now.
Dixon Dock.
I haven't heard of that place before.
Looking around, I can't see any activity whatsoever. There are some ancillary lights, but nothing of consequence. I can't see any movement in any of the structures. This place is dead.
The anomalous readings on the scanners have intensified. I don't think it's the beacon. The beacon signal is clean. This signal is very messy. It's like there's movement all around, but there's nothing here. There's nothing to suggest any movement whatsoever. I'm turning back around to have another look and head to the command center. The signal's starting to intensify. I'm really not sure what's going on. Roger that, Commander. We're also receiving some very strange signals ourselves. Seismic sensors are starting to flicker, and we're feeling a strange vibration in the hull. But it could possibly be some geothermal activity.
Roger that. Keep me apprised of the situation. I'm approaching the command station right now. I'm about to head out of the SRV and take a look at their computers. There is a lot of stuff here. Looks like we've made a big score.
Yeah, that's great to hear, Commander. Looks like it wasn't a waste of time coming to this worthless rock after all. Stand by for a moment, Commander. Seismic activity has just gone through the roof. What the? Commander, someone has just activated the airlock. There's something on the outside of the ship and seismic sensors are going crazy. Is it pirates? What's going on? Vasily, report. We are under attack. I don't know what it is. The ship is sinking. Oh my god, it's on the bridge. Commander, help! Vasily, report! Vasily, are you there? Come on, faster! Jesus Christ, where's the ship? What the? It's gone. This is impossible.
Vasily, come in, please. Anyone aboard the Hamilton, please respond.
Anyone, come in, please.
Jesus, this can't be happening. This can't be happening. Oh, God. Computer, scan the area. Where is the Hamilton?
The Hamilton is no longer in range of my scanners. Unable to locate.
It was right here. Check again.
I am sorry, Commander. I am unable to locate the Hamilton.
Check for interference.
There are a number of anomalies affecting the sensitivity of my scanners, but their effects are negligible.
Oh, shit. What's the status of life support?
This SRV currently has 5 hours of oxygen left.
Oh, great.
have any active life support modules?
Unknown. However, there seems to be extensive supplies according to some of the manifest terminals I was able to access, and their long-range transmitters are online.
Hopefully the colony has some data on surface scanners or something.
We can figure out what to do next. The ship has to be around here somewhere.
Commander, this is Vasily. Vasily? Are you okay? Where's the ship? What happened? It's okay, Commander. Come back to the settlement. It's safe. What the hell you mean safe? The ship's gone. We're all here, Commander. It's safe.
Vasily, what the hell's going on? And how the hell did you get to the settlement?
Come to the settlement. It's okay now.
What's wrong with you, Vasily?
It's safe, Commander. Vasily, what the hell is going on? Everything is okay. What the hell's wrong with you? Answer my questions. That's an order. Come back to the settlement.
Vasily, what's happened to you?
It's all okay. We are all here. It's safe. Come here, Commander. We are waiting for you. Vasily? Is that you? Oh my god. Commander, we are all here. It's safe. Come to the settlement. Be safe here. Commander, everything is okay.
There you go. What a creepy film. Reminiscent of Alien and Twilight Zone.
So one of the things I liked about it is it kind of captured that the atmosphere of
it does it really well, doesn't it? It's really quite creepy. And as you said, no character, well, characters a little bit at the beginning, but no other sign of a character anywhere.
Hey, Tracy, can you start my video again? It's telling me that my you've stopped my video.
Oh, did I? Apologies. hang on.
Yeah, well,
let me do that in a minute. Damien, over to you to sort the next one out.
I was going to say, I'll leave you to sort Ricky out when I talk about. I'm glad you enjoyed the Hamilton incident. It's one of my favourite films that I found this year, and I probably wouldn't have done if we hadn't been doing this podcast. So that was a good way. And there is a semi sequel video that still gives you no answers. They were going to continue the series, but. For some reason Vindicator Jones didn't, and in some ways I'm kind of glad because it makes it scarier not having the answers.
Yeah.
So my next film is very different in tone. It's called The Worst City Ever. Now a friend of mine sent me this as an introduction to the videos by Killian Experience, and he's got a very dry sort of twisted sense of humor which he puts into his videos. And for this one, he used a game called City Skylines, which is very similar to Sim City, and that you play a mayor of a city and you have to build up the city by building the houses and the skyscrapers and all the roads and all that kind of stuff. It's more of in the style of a Let's Play video where he's filming himself play the game. But unlike most Let's Play videos, he's actually got a very specific goal in mind that isn't really what the game's designed for, but he wants to do it to tell the story of this video that he's put together. And it's definitely a comedy video, so hopefully you will get a few good laughs out of this as you watch it. And if you do enjoy it, I do recommend his channel, because he applies this same sense of humor to pretty much all of his videos. Some of them are machinima that he's used various games for, some of them he just makes other sort of non-machinima videos. But I don't want to say, again, like the Hamilton, I don't want to say too much. I think it's just watch the video and see what you guys think, and hopefully you enjoy it as much as I do. So let's go for it.
Okay.
Christmas is right around the corner, and when I think Christmas, I think
dystopian megacity.
In science fiction, dystopian megacities are these oversized, financially unstable, deteriorating shitholes. And that's why I like them, I can relate. I think those traits can describe most of us. Today I'm going to show you how to build one in SimCity. We need a population of 10 million to be a megacity, so this will take more than 10 minutes. Yes, I know it's not a dystopian megacity yet. Kind of embarrassed by that name. That's better. I am learning the game, so give me 10 more minutes. I have managed to create a dystopian mega cozy village. I guess I can change the video's intro so I say that when I think Christmas, I think snow-covered houses. But that would be ridiculous! By now you may have noticed the eternal winter. City Skylines does not have seasons. If that annoys you, I think you're being a bit of a bigot. Remember, this game was made in Finland. Winter is all they got. When they made the summer maps, they had to guess what summer is like. That's why the game didn't ship with nighttime. They didn't know summer had it. But it makes sense here, because it's the future and this is nuclear winter. Now you might say, then why isn't there radiation everywhere? That's because radiation is a hoax, made up by the radiation suit industry. Can't be long now. Skyscrapers everywhere. I have named all the police stations cybernetic so we can pretend that they are robot cops. And everyone is complaining that they can't get rid of their corpses. Which makes no sense. Outside your window you have a perfectly fine river, what's the problem? Anyways, currently the city has a population of 103,000. How can we only have 103,000? It's gonna take days to reach 10 million. There we go, 149 million. If you call it fake, you are cyberbullying me. But I actually succeeded. That usually never happens in these types of videos, so why do I feel so empty? Because it looks too nice! In science fiction, you want to think, thank God I'm not living there because I would be murdered. Not, thank God I'm not living there because I would be murdered. By rent. We need some abandoned ugly buildings. What is the easiest way to scare off a neighbor? That's right, burning fossil fuels. Every house gets their very own oil power plant. Look at that, it's already working. Time for me to ride my motorcycle. Nope, still feeling empty. I'm actually getting depressed now. But the game doesn't have a psychiatrist or a drugstore. So to cheer us up, I'm going to build that tower I saw on The Simpsons that one time. Now I have forgotten all about the despair. And the only thing I can think about is that I need to build a monorail. The game doesn't have monorails. And look at that, I'm depressed again. Maybe that's it though. They are too happy. You can't be happy in a dystopian world. So how do I make them less happy? December. Of course. I'm going to steal Christmas. I shall remove every store so no one can buy presents. Har 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 har. What's that? Singing? In this park. They are still celebrating Christmas even though they have no presents. And it's located next to 6 coal power plants. That can't be healthy. But still. What happened then? Well, in Coal Park they say that Killian's small heart grew 3 sizes that day. That empty feeling is gone. Now that I see that people still celebrate Christmas on December 26th. What happened then? Well, in Coal Park they say that Killian's heart collapsed like a neutron star on crack. You're all fucking dead. Die, die, blood for the blood god.
That's crazy.
Yeah, he's definitely a crazy guy and he makes lots of crazy videos with that very similar sense of humor he showed there, which it's nice to see that. And it's also, City Skylines isn't a game that you would typically associate with creating machinima because it is just a construct a city game. There's no characters to look at or animate or anything like that. So that's one of the things I like seeing machinima, people making machinima, is they choose a game that you don't expect them to choose. Like there's some games that are very obvious, make perfect platforms for machinima, but then when you try something very different, I think that's very interesting to see.
Yeah, I mean, for me, that was about sort of really quite an interesting docu-style parody inspired Let's Play.
Yeah,
right.
Kind of illustrating really the creative goal that this guy had. So I always thought that was quite an interesting one about that particular film. Yeah. And the way he achieved it was through this really quite strategic approach to developing this particular type of environment that he wanted to.
Yeah.
And wonderful satire too, as well. Yeah.
Quite good with that, wasn't he?
Can you turn my video back on?
Oh gosh, hang on a moment.
And of course, perfect for this time of year.
No, I've just muted him. Oh no.
Poor Ricky.
Oh, what am I doing?
That's okay. I'm back.
Welcome back.
Oh, I'll get the hang of this eventually.
Yeah, that was one of the things that I really enjoyed this year is discovering Let's Play videos. They're generally not the kind of thing I like to watch, but Phil and Damien picked some really good ones this year, and I found myself really enjoying the satirical element to it.
Which I think
has been a part of Machinima from the beginning, that sort of laughing at the very games and parodying the omniscient narrator in endless National Geographic documentaries. I just love that.
Yeah. Sorry, did you just hear a bit of music there?
Nope.
Oh, that's good. That's like cock up with the playing of the videos. Beg your pardon.
I know lots of people do enjoy Let's Play videos, but if it's just someone playing the game, if it's a game that interests me, I want to play it myself. I don't want to watch someone else play it. And if it's a game that doesn't interest me, I don't want to see someone else play it because it doesn't interest me. So right. When it's in this sort of style where they're taking a game, but they're having fun with it and making you laugh or doing something really silly, that makes it a lot more interesting because that's not what you expect the game to be about.
There's another form of the Let's Play that I like a lot as well. And that's the sort of more serious informational Let's Play. For example, there's quite a few interesting Let's Play videos on Half-Life, the story, the background of Half-Life. Mm. And for example, there was one I watched recently that says that wanted to point out what the actual living condition of somebody living in Half-Life 2, what it would be like for them, the kind of oppression, fascist oppression, and the things they'd have to face all the time. And you know, when you're playing the game, you're more focused on the actual action of the game, and the background is just there to enhance that. But when you really look at the creative side of it, the world that they created, the rules, the characters, it really becomes more impressive. And so these Let's Play videos are almost individual essays on their perception of the story and the world and all of that. I find those fascinating.
Absolutely. Okay, conscious of time. Our final film this evening, I think it'd be fair to say, Ricky, we're probably gonna run out of time, but we'll see. We'll see when we're done this. So the film that I want to show next is actually a music video. And it's been one I've actually revisited a few times throughout the year. And for me, it really kind of epitomized lockdown in all its creative glory. It was released in February and it was created by a guy in his home in 3 weeks. I have to say, albeit using some pretty amazing tech. The film's called Baby Outlaw. It was made in Unreal by a guy called Xanadu to the El King song. And we covered it in our March episode. And it was another of those we all thought was a lot of fun. So I'm going to let this one play. And I'm going to let it play right to the end where it shows you how the guy made it as well. So just bear with me whilst I fire this one up. Let me just hold on a sec. I'm sharing the screen here. It's a bit tricky.
What's up, everybody? What's better than a walking blur?
That talks.
What's up?
He was terrified.
So there you go. That, to me, was a game changer in thinking about... I've killed Ricky again. Are you back?
Yep, there we go.
Ah, wonderful. Sorry about that.
No, that's okay.
Yeah, so that was, for me, was, you know, right back to the comments that I made at the beginning, which was really, you know, the Mandalorian was a game changer in the real time, in actual industry sector. This is not Mandalorian. This is stuff done at home. So it's professional standard mocap for sure. But we've seen mocap used, markerless motion capture in particular, used to great effect in a lot of videos that we've reviewed through the year. It frankly doesn't have to be as complex as Xanadu was sort of illustrating in this particular video. But I think what impressed me with this particular one was the lip sync and the comedy timing. This guy's great.
Yeah.
It was a lot of fun. And I think it's an excellent example of the kit and the creative coming together to deliver something, well, what I'd call really entertaining magic. And I have to say, the other thing that we've done through the year is reviewed some fantastic music videos as well. And this one we reviewed as early as February, so it was episode 2 of the podcast, when we were all thinking, you know, has Machinima really got a future? Episode 2, this was one that kind of cropped up, and I think we were all realizing that we were in a different world to Machinima had been. And some of the stuff that we've reviewed by JT Music, formerly JT Machinima, has also been of outstanding quality, where they're creating their own lyrics as well.
And they're
selling that content and creating it for, you know, game environments like Fortnite and what have you, under license, which is also fantastic to see. So, you know, as I said, where Baby Outlaw and Xanadu are basically indie, the production values here, I think, are writ large through it.
Exactly. I think I want to suggest that we skip the My Last Film. We can include that in a blog post or a written post and continue our discussion, because I think we need to talk a little bit more about what we're doing. Besides my my film would basically reflect what we've just seen, which is using real-time tech in a game engine. Here was Unreal. The film I chose was made in Unreal as well. And it, your film is just as representative of some of the ideas I wanted to share as mine is. So we don't have to do my film.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so what I wanted to say is that originally we talked about Obit, film Phil Rice's sort of throwback to the original Machinima technique, which is hack the game, use those hack tools to create, and use the content from the open world game to create your film. Now, in real-time cinema, you have an open, an actual game, an actual game engine that is built for free, that gives you all the tools to be able to make a game. And in the process, and as they do that, they also give you the tools for making a film inside of the game engine. And they give you all the tools you need. You can bring in original mocap, you can buy animation film, you can get all the content you need, you can get it free, you can buy it, you can create your own worlds, you can import landscapes. All you need is a script and possibly help to do some of the voice acting in it. And it shows in this case that you have a fellow who has a little bit of money, because some of those tools that he had were somewhat expensive. You can produce an incredibly professional level. You can make the gap between amateur and professional so narrow as to be non-existent anymore, which is also another trend that I've seen in animation and in machinima in particular. So you have a film. Phil Rice made the a film in the traditional machinima techniques, and Outlaw is made in contemporary machinima real-time techniques. And you can see that both have their own uniqueness to them, but they're worlds apart in terms of how they're created technically.
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the things I noticed about Baby Outlaw is it's made in Unreal, which is the exact same platform that The Mandalorian uses. Yeah. So I know that in The Mandalorian, they have all this expensive camera equipment and the big studio space, but at its core, it's the exact same tool set that this guy at home has used that they're making the official TV show with, which right. I think is a nice sort of connection between the two as well, because it's not just a Star Wars video. It's very related to the same sort of software and technology they use for the real stuff.
Right.
Yeah. And I think, you know, with tool sets beginning to be more widely used, like Omniverse, then what you have the potential for is the collaboration, the international collaboration, which we've always seen with machinima, but which was always a bit more tricky using the tools of the day.
Right.
But with something like Omniverse, a much more accessible approach with a professional output as a consequence. It's a game changer. Yes. It's a game changer. Okay, so conscious of time, it's 7:30. We said we were going to wrap up at 7:30. So all I wanted to say is thank you very much for joining us this evening. On behalf of the Completely Machinima podcast team, thanks for watching us and listening to us through the year and hearing about the trends and tales that we've observed from the world of machinima in 2020-2021. We're going to try and do something a little bit different next year, which we'll talk about in our various episodes of our podcast. So we'll give you an update on that in next week's podcast, actually, which comes out on Thursday. A recording of this evening's session is going to be available on our blog page as well, along with all the links, because I'm conscious I didn't actually post them as we were going through, but I'll do that. So that you've got all the links to the original films. And I hope the original creators of the work forgive us for the fact that we were streaming them. So didn't want anything to fail with YouTube lag whilst we were doing tonight's presentation. Hopefully it all ran through smoothly via YouTube for you. As I said, we tend to release our blogs, our episodes of the podcast on Thursdays. What we are about is reviewing some amazing films by indie creators. And next week, what we're going to be doing is putting a bit of a Christmas twist to that as well. And then I said, as I said, in January, we're going to be switching to a more visual format. And we'll update you about that next week. So in the meantime, happy Christmas and wishing you all the best in the new year.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
And bye for now. Okay, I've just closed the stream because it lags a bit.
Yeah.
I'm just going to kill the recording. Stop recording.